It's really a pleasure to welcome back to the store, Jacob Weisberg. Jake last spoke here about 8 years ago for his book, The Bush Tragedy, about the administration of George W. Bush. And he credits P&P with helping to push that book to bestseller status. So we'll see what we can do for his new book about Ronald Reagan, called appropriately Ronald Reagan. This work is part of the American Presidential Series, which is a series of concise but comprehensive biographies written by some quite accomplished authors and published by Times Books. Arthur Schlesinger, who until his death 9 years ago edited this series, said the point of the project was to produce volumes, quote, compact enough for the busy reader, lucid enough for the student, authoritative enough for the scholar. And Jake's work on Reagan certainly fits that mold. He's managed in a slim 154 pages of text, not only to capture Reagan's extraordinary life, but also to bore in on several issues of particular significance, among them the role Reagan played in ending the Cold War and the seeming impenetrableness of Reagan's mind. Jake brought to the task a long career in journalism that has included stints with Newsweek and the New Republic, pieces for the New York Times Magazine, the Financial Times, and Vanity Fair, and years as editor and now chairman of the Slate Group. Now, it's true, Jake's political leanings have tended more toward the liberal than the conservative, but that didn't keep him from approaching the subject of Reagan with a very open mind and writing an admirably fair and balanced portrait of a complex American political figure. Jake calls Reagan the second most important president of the 20th century after FDR, and shows there was much more to Reagan than the usual stereotypes promoted by both Democrats and Republicans. So ladies and gentlemen, please join me in welcoming Jacob Weisberg.
Thank you, Bradley, for that kind introduction. And I just want to say I love this bookstore, not just because I do think it helped put my last book on the bestseller list, but Bradley and Alyssa have done an amazing job with it. It's really one of the best independent bookstores in the country. And, you know, you're lucky to have it here in Washington, and I'm lucky to be speaking here tonight. This book, it is a short book. I consider that a virtue, although some biographies are often, it's often considered a virtue to be as long as possible. I had to take the opposite approach here. This is really an exercise in distillation, in trying to figure out what's essential in the Ronald Reagan story, but also along the way, trying to take on some of these myths. There are myths on the left about Reagan that I think it's a myth that he was a dunderhead. There are myths on the right about Reagan. I think it's a myth that he was always a man of principle and didn't bend and didn't negotiate. In fact, Reagan was much more of a pragmatist and improviser than I think people, if you were to hear the version of him represented in, say, a Republican presidential debate. I think it's the reality is very different. But I thought I'd talk tonight a little bit just about some of the things that I found really interesting that I learned doing this book, and parts of the story that maybe people haven't paid quite as much attention to that I think are really interesting and important. And the first thing I wanted to talk about a little bit is Reagan's childhood. Reagan wrote about his childhood. The first place he wrote about it in any detail was when he wrote an autobiography in 1964, a book called Where's the Rest of Me?, which he wrote when he was moving from his career in Hollywood to running for governor of California. And he wanted to explain why he had moved from the left to the right. And he, in the process, sort of told his life story. And he writes about growing up in these small towns in downstate in western Illinois and Iowa, and paints this idyllic picture. He calls it a Huck Finn, Tom Sawyer idol. He didn't necessarily get the kind of darker side of Huck Finn. But, you know, he describes sort of being out in the woods in this beautiful prairie setting and ice skates of the river, the Rock River would freeze over in the winter, and you put on ice skates and you could hold your coat up and the wind would carry you down the river on ice skates. And he describes this small town community, this neighborly life, and he loved everything about it. He says, you know, we didn't have a lot of money, but we had a, you know, warm family life, and my mother would make this delicious thing called oatmeal meat, which was basically oatmeal and meat. Anyway, so you read this and you think, what a happy childhood. Then you hear about his brother Neil recounting the same events. He's a brother who is older by a couple of years, and Neil says, you know, well, Dad was a terrible alcoholic. We went from town to town. By the time Reagan was 10 years old, he'd lived in 10 different houses. They went to Chicago at one point where his dad got a job. His dad got arrested for public drunkenness. They had to leave Chicago. They were kind of being driven from pillar to post because of his father's alcoholism. And oatmeal meat was a thing. I mean, Neil said, I never want to taste that again. It's like, you know, something you eat if you can't afford anything else. It's basically oatmeal and meat, and, you know, maybe you put some salt in it. It's just, it keeps you barely alive. They would go to the butcher and say, do you have any liver? Liver wasn't something that was considered a great food to eat then. Do you have any liver left over for the cat? And they would take that home and make dinner out of it. So a totally different perspective on how they grew up. And, you know, Reagan's, he told these anecdotes again and again and again. One of his favorite stories, which I'm sure you've all heard, is about the parents who take their two sons to the psychiatrist because the one son is such an optimist and the other son is such a pessimist. And the psychiatrist takes the pessimistic son into a room filled with toys. And the pessimistic son said, well, that's going to break anyway. And then he takes the optimistic son into a room filled with horse crap. And the kid gets out a shovel and starts digging. And the psychiatrist says, what are you doing? He said, well, with all this horse crap, there's got to be a pony in here somewhere. And Reagan thought that was a funny story. It's Reagan and his brother. That's the one was the optimist. The other was the pessimist. And at some level, you say, well, this is just congenital. This is the view of the world. And I think that that's true to some extent. Reagan was by nature an optimist, but he had to figure out how to preserve that optimism in these really tough circumstances where he was growing up. You know, at one point, his father left the family for a mistress in another town. The parents never ended up really splitting up. They got back together. But this was a tough, tough, poor childhood, you know, that went into the Depression era when they just didn't have enough to keep body and soul together. And what I think Reagan did, and this is a little bit of a psychological theory that explains some of his behavior, but to be an optimist, having this kind of life, he learned to tune things out. He learned to not see things that were unpleasant to him, that made it hard to maintain that he was having a happy childhood. He sort of would choose not to hear certain things. He was a very isolated kid. He didn't have a lot of friends, partly because he was being dragged from place to place and would have to make new friends every year. He made that a positive. He loved being by himself. He loved being alone. But this thing about not hearing things he didn't want to hear and not seeing things he didn't want to see was also physiological. When he was 13 years old, he loved sports. He loved playing football. He wanted to play baseball, but he couldn't play baseball basically because he couldn't see the ball. But he only discovered this when he was 13 and he was driving somewhere and he tried on his mother's glasses and he said, oh my God, it's all clear now. So he was sort of in this visual fog for his whole childhood. But then there are these very interesting things. He writes in that first book, he hated wearing his glasses. People always thought, oh, he's a vain Hollywood actor. He hates wearing his glasses. No, he just kind of preferred things a little blurry. And likewise with his hearing, when he was on some of the first movies he made in Hollywood, when he got there in the late 1930s, were the Brass Bancroft movies, in which he plays this heroic FBI agent who breaks up, you know, smuggling rings and counterfeiters. And in one of them, there was a action scene they were shooting. Somebody fired a blank gun right next to his ear, basically left him deaf in one ear. And I don't know if his hearing was that good before that. And all those problems, those physiological problems, got worse over time. His hearing got worse. His eyesight got worse. But I also think this was really, really functional behavior. Because in his whole, through his life, when there were things that he preferred not to deal with because they were unhappy or unpleasant or involved conflict or in politics involved contradictions that he didn't want to deal with, he had this way of tuning out and letting it be someone else's problem, letting it be someone else's issue. And you see this in his family life. You know, his daughter Patty had a very, very difficult relationship with Nancy, her mother, and claimed Nancy beat her. And Reagan just didn't want to deal with that. He just tuned it out. And it's not that different from what happens in 1981 when David Stockman comes to him and says, look, you can have the defense build up, you can have the tax cuts, or you can get rid of the deficit. But you can't do all three because the numbers don't add up. And Stockman describes this frustration in not getting Reagan to be able to understand that these things were contradictory. I don't think Reagan didn't understand it, but he didn't have a solution to it. And the path of least resistance was to allow the deficit to grow and to not fully engage in the problem and leave it to AIDS. So I think he learned through his life and through his political career that tuning out was functional behavior and an effective political technique for him. And I think people often, when they would see the way he would distance himself and not engage and tune out, they would think, oh, he's clueless, he's out of it. But of course, the great poignancy of this is that at some point, Alzheimer's kicks in. And there's been an interesting debate probably since he was first acknowledged that he had Alzheimer's several years after leaving the White House when he wrote this kind of moving letter to the country in 1994 about when Alzheimer's started to have an effect. There's actually a sort of delicious fight going on right now between Bill O'Reilly and George Will about it. And George Will says Bill O'Reilly in his Killing Reagan book has libeled Reagan and, you know, made the by saying that Alzheimer's was affecting him earlier in his presidency. In fact, I looked at the O'Reilly book because I was interested in this. He doesn't say what Will says he accuses him of saying, which was that the assassination attempt and the recovery from that sort of kickstarted his Alzheimer's. He said it had a big physical effect on him, which everybody around Reagan said it did, that Reagan was just, you know, slower, his hearing is worse, his recognition of people was worse after he was shot. But I think the best evidence suggests that Alzheimer's really started to affect him in 1986, around the time of Iran-Contra, around the time when he was most embarrassingly unable to remember what had happened. And, you know, people assumed it was convenient not remembering. I think by that point, it's actual not remembering. I think when this question of what did he know and when did he know it became a sort of epistemological conundrum because he didn't know what he knew at that point. And with Alzheimer's, those were still the relatively earlier stages, and he had good days and he had bad days, and he had days when you could see him and think, boy, that guy's out of it, and he had days when you could see him and think he was the same person he was 10 years before and it wasn't affecting him at all. But at some point, this fog, which he'd always in a certain sense cultivated, became a real fog. And I find a almost kind of poetry in that he sort of drifted away into this fogginess that he created himself. Another aspect of Reagan's earlier career that I think is really, really understudied is this period in the 1950s when he moved from the left to the right. Household Reagan grew up in was a New Deal household. They were FDR supporters. Reagan revered FDR his whole life, even after he moved to the right. And he was a liberal Democrat. He was an anti-communist. He was a liberal anti-communist. But he campaigned for Truman, and he voted for Truman in 1952. In 1954, he was still, if you'd asked him what his views were, or asked someone else who knew him what his views were, they'd say he's a liberal Democrat. 1962, 8 years later, he is so conservative that General Electric, which had been employing him as spokesman, said, we can't have this guy around. He's embarrassing us. And he'd adopted this view that basically liberalism was just a short stop on the way to socialism, that there was a continuum between democratic liberalism and communism, and we were sliding down that slippery slope. Part of it was came out of the Hayek book, The Road to Serfdom, which he read and which influenced him. But what happened in those 8 years? I mean, that's a huge gap from Truman Democrat to Goldwater conservative. And it's almost a blank period in Reagan's life, because everything before that is his Hollywood career, which is incredibly well documented. It's documented the way a Hollywood star's life is documented. You know, he's covered as a celebrity. There are pictures of everywhere he went. Everything he wrote, you know, was writing in celebrity magazines at the time, things being written about him. There's tons of documentation. Once he went into politics, everything is documented. This period when he moved to left to right is like a hole. What he did during those years was he went to work for General Electric. He was the host of GE Theater, which was this weekly television show where they would do, it was a playhouse where they would have 1 week a drama, 1 week a comedy, different actors. It was one of the first television shows that got famous film actors to appear on television. And he hosted it, and he'd introduce it. Some weeks he'd acted in it. Some of you might have seen, there's a great one where he acts opposite James Dean. And I said, this young man's going to be a big star. He also was a kind of traveling spokesman for General Electric. General Electric was a huge company, had factories all over the country making different kinds of appliances, giant turbines, you know, light bulbs, everything from consumer appliances to huge industrial appliances. And Reagan would go around to all these factories and facilities, and he would speak to all the workers. And he was there partly because he was a celebrity and they, you know, wanted him representing the country, but he was also supposed to be the face of GE, and he was kind of representing GE management and GE's view of the world. And when you start to look at what the GE view of the world was at that point, it's an amazing match for what Reagan ended up thinking by the latter part of that period. So very opposed to government regulation. Why is government interfering in our business? Very opposed to taxation and higher taxes. These taxes are killing us. What's government doing to support the business climate? Reagan starts using this term where he talks about the business climate, which is a GE phrase. The guy who was head of public affairs for GE actually coined this phrase, business climate, which now everybody uses all the time. And the view of the world he represented was this 1950s corporate view, which was very specifically GE's view and the view that GE wanted to propound to its workers. And I don't think Reagan, you know, took this on cynically or you know, thought he was being a propagandist for GE. He was a big reader, but I think a lot of the reading he was getting was coming through General Electric. He was reading a lot of the literature from the early conservative movement at that time. He was a charter subscriber to William F. Buckley's National Review. He read Whitaker Chambers' Witness, which was an incredibly influential book on the right. Some people said he almost memorized that book. He read Hayek. And I think these books and going around, having all of this connection to the GE corporate world really influenced him and took him so far that by the end of that period, he sort of has the view that government can do no good and business can do no ill. And it was really a blind spot, I think you could say, for the remainder of his career, was that he was sort of incapable of believing that government can be effective outside of national defense and maybe, you know, a few other functions. And he never thinks business does anything wrong. That's not part of his vocabulary to think that business could be abusive or coercive or monopolistic. He's always defending the prerogatives of big business. It's really hard to tap that out. I went to the Reagan Library, and the file on the GE years has like 30 pages in it. There's not a single surviving copy of a speech or a recording that anybody has found of any of these hundreds, if not thousands, of speeches he gave on factory floors and at GE facilities. There are some speeches he gave at the period. There's some correspondence. There's some bits and pieces. But it's almost like detective work to try to put together this gap in his career, which I sort of think is central to everything, because it's not only where his views emerge, but because his views form the core of the modern conservative movement and define the conservative era that began with his election in 1980. This question of where it all came from ends up being pretty important. Maybe just as a last bit, and then we can open it all up for questions. But just to talk about Reagan's role in the end of the Cold War and the collapse of communism, which is also very contested and very interesting ground. When I went out to the Reagan Library, the best thing I did was they said after I'd been there a few days, they said the librarian was very nice, came over. They don't have that many visitors there, these presidential libraries, and they have a lot of staff who are super helpful. She said, would you like to see the stuff in Reagan's desk? And I said, sure, what's that? And she said, well, you know, his desk was, they boxed up all the stuff, and they have that, and you can request permission to look inside the box of what he had in his desk. And it turned out that this was stuff that it's not exactly clear which desk at which time it was all in, but I'm pretty sure it was the stuff that was in his desk in his home in Pacific Palisades that he took with him to the governor's mansion in Sacramento and then ultimately took to the White House and had in his desk in the White House. So when he left the White House, it was put in boxes, and it was like, you know, old desk diaries, and it was just like the stuff you have that stays in your desk. And so there's a kind of, you know, poignant, iconic quality. What are these things that he held on to? And there are a few speeches, you know, and some of them are speeches that you'd heard before, but for some reason these were speeches that he kept in his desk. There was this one thing that he'd written in 1962, which had never been published, and it was a kind of essay he'd written. Now, he was writing at that time essays. He wasn't doing his radio commentaries yet, but he wrote a lot. I mean, it's one of the really surprising things about Reagan. He probably wrote every day of his life. And he was a good writer. He wrote for the human voice. He wrote as someone who had developed his early career on radio. He wrote to read, not to be read on the page. But he was always writing these little essays and commentaries. And in this one, written in 1962, he says, it's possible that communism will take over and, you know, that it will end in nuclear war and conflict. But you know what? I think it's more likely that communism, the Soviet Union, will just collapse. He said, because he said, communism isn't even a political system or an economic system. It's just a form of insanity. He said, it's a violation of human nature. It doesn't make any sense. Nobody would want to live like that. And it's just, you know, in this essay, and he kind of plays this out. You read this, you think, wow, that's a really interesting view, because people on the right didn't think that then. They didn't think communism was going to collapse. But it was sort of Reagan applying his common sense perspective on anything, on everything, to communism. He said, it doesn't make any sense for people to live like that. Nobody would tolerate it. If they knew how we live, they wouldn't stand for it. And he had this kernel of an idea that he held on to. And you find it repeated in various forms when he starts to do these really interesting radio commentaries in the late 1970s, which were the place he really developed his political ideas between his losing campaign for president in 1976 when he challenged Gerald Ford and his winning campaign in 1980. And that eccentric view matched up with some other eccentric views he had. You find also reading these commentaries, Reagan hated nuclear weapons. He'd been a pacifist. He called himself a pacifist in the 1930s. Partly it was, you know, his early involvement in theater. He would go to all these plays. He went to see, when he was very young, like 19 years old, this play, Journey's End, which is a play about the First World War, a British play that's kind of a pacifist play. It's about the waste of the First World War and the trench warfare and these young men dying pointlessly. That had a huge impact on him. Another thing that had a huge impact on him was when he was in the Second World War making training films in Hollywood, but at a military base, the base was sent these early films of the liberation of Auschwitz. There's this myth thing that's totally untrue. It's said about Reagan that he claimed that he was one of the people who liberated Auschwitz. He never said anything like that. It's the kind of thing you can only believe if you don't actually know the story of Reagan. But he did see in 1945 films of the emaciated prisoners, the piles of corpses, and it had a huge effect on him. He actually, Ron Jr. remembers his father trying to make him watch this years later, because he says, you have to understand this about humanity, that this is possible. But that was another thing that influenced this idea he had, that nuclear war would be totally horrifying and unacceptable. And he thought, especially after he became president and the assassination attempt, that his mission was to reduce the threat of nuclear weapons. And you know, the conventional view, the conservative view, is that, well, he had the strategy of peace through strength, came into office, big military buildup, you know, make the Soviet Union bankrupt, force them to collapse and surrender. I don't think that's at all what happened if you look at the record. He was desperate for a connection and negotiation with the Soviet leaders. In the Reagan Library, you can find these handwritten letters, long handwritten letters he wrote to every Soviet leader when he was president, starting with Brezhnev, Chernyenko, Andropov, Chernyenko, finally Gorbachev. And these letters, they're really touching. He says, you know, he says, you and I have the power to destroy the world, but we also have the power to save the world and make peace. And we have to be able to communicate. We have to meet. We have to talk to each other. He was reaching out to try to form a connection. And he would get back these letters that were in this Leninist boilerplate about Western imperialism. And, you know, there was clearly, I mean, all these guys were dying, we now know, one after the other. But there was, he wasn't able to make any connection. And he was terribly frustrated by that and terribly upset about it. And all the time the defense buildup is going on during the first term, when it's the sort of heyday of the neoconservatives and this hawkish view of the world, Reagan's on board for that, but he's also really, really unhappy because he thinks the world is getting more dangerous. And when he finds out, basically from a CIA briefing, that the Soviets actually think that the United States might attack, that we have aggressive designs on them, he's shocked. How could they think that? We would never do that. And he, I think in his second term, didn't continue that strategy. He turned around completely. The second term in relation to the Soviets is more like a repudiation of the first term and an acknowledgement that what he tried during the first term didn't work. He didn't scare them to the bargaining table. And at that point, Reagan becomes an apostle of radical disarmament. I mean, really radical disarmament, more radical than almost anybody on the left supported. He keeps saying in meetings, why can't we abolish all nuclear weapons? And of course, this is tied up with something of a fantasy about Star Wars, as he thinks you can replace nuclear weapons with a nuclear shield. Be that as it may, he wanted to get rid of them. And he's constantly at these meetings with Gorbachev trying to make the more radical proposal to get rid of the weapons. And at that point, he's really at odds with almost everybody in his own administration. All of the foreign policy people around him think this is a crazy idea. They think he's lost his marbles. They think it doesn't make any sense. One person supported him. It was George Shultz. He had the Secretary of State said, look, this is what the president wants. I think he's right. And, you know, we have to figure out if they negotiate an agreement like this, which they came very close to doing at Reykjavik, until Reagan walked out over Gorbachev not being willing to accept the Star Wars research he wanted. If they had agreed to that, you know, we have to be prepared to implement it. And I think the picture of Reagan that emerges in the second term is it goes back to these early roots, to his early pacifism, to this whole history he had of being an opponent of nuclear weapons. And it's has a lot of relationship to the story we've been told, but it's not exactly the same story. I think you see in the second term a very different president that you'd see in the first term, not because he's gone soft in the head, but because he's activated some views that are really at odds with what he was known for previously. Maybe I'll stop there. That's a lot of food for thought, I hope. And thank you. And yes, come to the microphone if you have any questions. Sir? Just one microphone.
You've got a camera tonight and a microphone. I really enjoyed that very much. I thought it was great balance for the whole, you know, the whole life, and it certainly raised a lot of questions in my mind. But most of those you've sort of at least partly answered already. The one that I'm not clear on is sort of his entrance into politics, or in his sort of personal interest in getting into politics, coming from a family of somewhat dysfunctional, I guess, but also a family not of great means or anything. And as far as I can tell, his father wasn't involved particularly in politics, or mother. So just when did he get the idea that he could kind of take part in that, as opposed to having ideas about, you know, having political ideas?
Yeah.
The other part of it, I guess I'll just throw this in just to, because I have the opportunity to do so. You mentioned that his GE years, his General Electric years, ended in a situation where GE felt he was too far to the right. I always thought of GE as having lured him to the right, that that he was kind of born of the left and was still of the left when GE made some sort of overture to him to take part in their GE hour or whatever, and that he was very, pleased with that and kind of lured into more, at least thinking along the lines of corporate America.
Mm-hmm. Well, let's
move so quickly? I don't know. Anyway, but mostly, how did he get into politics?
Yeah, great question. I'll do the second one first. I think GE didn't want to be perceived as being having a political, taking political sides publicly. So when he got too far out, it was a problem for them. There's actually the excerpt from the book, which we ran in Slate today, includes the interesting issue about GE firing him and why they fired him. And I have a theory about that, too. I think it involved this antitrust case that had been brought against GE. GE executives actually went to jail in a price-fixing case right around then. And at the same time, Reagan was being investigated in a price, in an antitrust case around his work in the Screen Actors Guild. And he'd been called to testify before a grand jury, which not many people knew about at the time. But I think it was the risk to embarrassment on that issue. On GE, Reagan had his own myth about what Reagan thought that GE had fired him because he was too conservative and because he was speaking his mind about the government. But I think the evidence suggests that that wasn't actually the reason why they got rid of him. On the why Reagan went into politics, he did his family his during the Depression. Both his father and his brother got patronage jobs, working for the New Deal, WPA type jobs, and there was, I think, a political awareness in the family. I think he'd always enjoyed arguing politics. He was always interested in politics. There are lots of descriptions of him, you know, holding forth, you know, defending FDR. He was famous at the radio station where he worked in Davenport, Iowa, for doing this great FDR imitation. He would do imitations of FDR's fireside chats. And when he got to Hollywood, he was a Hollywood politician. You know, he sought out election and leadership in the Screen Actors Guild. He became a figure in the blacklist. That's complicated, something we didn't talk about, but part of it is I think he just enjoyed politics and was always interested in it. The other side of it is I think Reagan had a pretty good self-awareness about certain things. He knew he wasn't a great actor. He thought he was. He knew what his strengths were as an actor. He was reliable. He was on time. You know, there was no monkey business from him. But he knew he was limited in his range. He could only do certain parts. He was always frustrated with the parts he was getting. And I think at a fairly early stage, after the Second World War, his career never really got going again. So I think at that point he started to think about what else he could do. And he'd been approached to run for Congress as a Democrat a couple of times in the 1940s, and he'd passed it up. But he was, I think he had his eye on that from a pretty early stage. Sir?
I'd like to echo what the previous speaker said, thanking you for a very nuanced picture and, you know, questioning some of the myths on both sides. In terms of question, if I could do a double one, procedurally, how long did it take you to research and write the book? The second substantive one is, okay, Reagan has big ideas about things like communism and business. Does he think much about how the government works, how it might work, or is he kind of detached from that sort of stuff?
Well, on the practicalities of writing the book, it depends how you measure it. I've been in some ways I've been thinking about Reagan my whole life. I was trying to promote my book on Facebook, and some of my high school friends were responding, and one of them reminded me that in the mock debate that we had in my high school in 1980, I played the Reagan part. But I played the Reagan part not because I was a Reagan supporter, but because there were no Reagan supporters at my very liberal progressive high school, and someone had to take a bullet, and I did it. But I was thinking about Reagan, you know, at that point I was 16 years old, so I've been thinking about it and following it, but you know, I'd never fully engaged with it, and I think the sort of reading and thinking and research part of the book was a couple of years. The writing of that book, as you see, it's a slim volume. I think I did in under a year.
And yeah. Reagan's idea about how the government works.
Yeah. Well, I think it's an astute question because it points to the answer, which is that I don't think he had a sophisticated or detailed understanding of what government did in most cases. It's a little bit bifurcated. I mean, as a governor and to some extent as a president, Reagan was very practical about government and worked with the other side, was very ready to compromise. And if you look at what he did in California, ended up with, in some ways, a very strong progressive liberal role. He doubled state's funding for higher education, you know, helped to build, although he was often seen as being at odds with it, with the state's great university system. He was a very good environmental president. He protected a lot of land in California. I don't mean president, governor, sorry. Protected a lot of land in California. He got very involved in a big welfare reform bill, which was kind of ahead of its time. It was in some ways the origin of the idea of workfare, replacing welfare with jobs at a time when the Nixon White House was supporting a guaranteed income, which Reagan played a big role in defeating by going to Washington and testifying before the Senate that it was a bad idea. And it was, again, Reagan's sort of common sense approach. He said, how can it be a good idea to pay people for not working? People won't work if you do that. And that was sort of, that was the level at which he often engaged with programs. He was thoughtful about government in certain ways, but he was possessed of this idea that more government meant less freedom and that you simply wanted less of it. When it came to following through on that notion, he often sort of threw up his hands, gave up, didn't pursue it. But if you asked him, he would always oppose government taking on any additional function, any expanded role, once he got to the White House.
Hi. Do you have anything to say about the role of Nancy's father, Dr. Davis, in all this? He apparently, very conservative physician, and almost filled in some respects the role of dad in Ronald's life.
Yeah, I mean that's there is one theory of Reagan's moving to the right is that there was a lot he fell under the influence of Nancy's father. They spent a lot of time together in. Nancy's parents were friends with Barry Goldwater. They would all vacation in Arizona. Reagan got to know Goldwater through his father-in-law and them being family friends. But I think in the end it had happened by that point. First of all, you know, Nancy herself didn't really have – she wasn't particularly political when she met Reagan. I mean, she ended up really adopting and following his politics to the extent that she had her own view of things. But Loyal Davis was her father, and you know he's sometimes portrayed as anti-Semite and a bigot, and you know this sort of ultra conservative. It's one of the things that's plausible, but the evidence isn't really there. You know, there's all this correspondence. You don't find correspondence between them. You don't find accounts of them. The timing doesn't quite add up. I think part of what is interesting and surprising about Reagan's move to the right is the extent to which he did do it on his own. It was the product of his reading, his thinking. He is writing things all this time. Reagan wasn't an intellectual, but he was
reader and writer and original in a certain way, and he had to come to ideas, even if they were ideas held by a lot of other people, through this independent path. Thanks.
Well, I was going to ask the question of what effect Nancy Reagan and Jane Wyman, was that his other wife, had on his political thought. I think maybe you partially answered one of on Nancy's father. My procedural question was, on this series of the presidents, I went to a lecture at the Smithsonian about 15 years ago, moderated by Professor Schlesinger, and there were such scintillating books on Franklin Pierce and Chester Arthur and all. I thought the series sort of went away when Dr. Schlesinger died. I may have imagined it, but I thought John Dean wrote the book on Warren Harding, but maybe is it still going on? I mean, are we going to have books on Obama and...
Yes, I mean they're all done now except for Clinton, which is in progress. And Obama, I assume they'll do it at some point. I mean, I think it might be years from now. But they've done almost all the presidents, and they're all written by different people. Some are historians, some are journalists, and some are harder than others. Gail Collins, New York Times columnist, had William Henry Harrison, who was president for 30 days and was basically in a coma the whole time. And the book's basically supposed to be about the presidency. So she said there was nothing. She used every piece of information she could find. There was nothing left on the cutting room floor. Reagan, it was the opposite. You have this wealth of material. There's so much stuff, and you have to digest it down. So these end up, they're parallel, but they're very different kinds of exercises.
Were you strictly limited to 200 pages or some amount?
I think it's a word limit, which I exceeded, but not by too much. I mean, that's also the point of it. It's to keep them down. But I think they're supposed to be somewhere in the range of 40,000 to 50,000 words. I'll answer your other question briefly about his other wives, because I do think it's interesting and relevant. Jane Wyman, his first wife, I think he was very, when that marriage came to an end, Jane Wyman left him, and I think it was one of the things that helped to produce the sort of dynamic I was talking about at the beginning, where he didn't hear things, didn't see things, isolated himself. Now, to some extent, the failure of the marriage was a result of that, because she sort of felt he wasn't completely there and couldn't get through to him. He'd had an earlier relationship. He'd been engaged when he was in college to a woman he grew up with called Margaret Cleaver, and she broke off the engagement and sent him back his ring. She said he couldn't tell. Mm-hmm. She said he couldn't tell the difference between fact and fancy, which was an interesting observation. Mm-hmm. But I think both of those relationships ending surprised him and left him even more feeling he couldn't trust people. He was on his own. He didn't want people to know him, to understand mm-hmm. him. And it's part of this impenetrable quality, this sense that people can't really understand what was going on inside his head. It's not because there was nothing going on inside his head. It's because he became very self-protective based on all of these experiences. And I think his first marriage was very much the story of that. The story of his second marriage is he finally found someone he trusted. I mean, I think if you say who in his life was Reagan really close to, it's his mother, and we know very little about that relationship because neither of them really wrote anything about it, and Nancy.
Thank you, sir.
Yeah, thanks.
Well, that last thing you said really speaks to my question, and I was so glad to hear you talk about Reagan's preferring an unrealistic, rosy picture of the world, because I'm a clinical social worker, I'm a psychotherapist, and something that I've always wondered about Reagan, and particularly when I read the biography by, and I was trying to think of his name coming over, he's the one who put himself in the...
Yeah, that would be Edmund Morris.
Edmund Morris.
Yeah.
And there were little things in there. You talk of his preference for seeing the world being different from what it was. And in my business, there's such a thing called dissociation, dissociative behavior, dissociative thinking. And what it means is you leave reality. And we all do it sometimes when we daydream. Daydream is dissociative. It's can be conscious. This is boring, I think I'll just drift off. But the more you go towards pathology, the less voluntary it is. It's always deliberate, but as far as being consciously deliberate, it gets less and less and less so.
Right.
And I've always wondered if Ronald Reagan, as you, I thought you were saying, sort of chose this as a conscious thing to do. My impression has been he just, it happened to him.
Yeah.
He had to zone out.
Well, so I think, I like the way you put it. I mean, I think you start to do this. I don't think you do it consciously, but if it works for you, it's functional, and you do it more. Right, so I don't think Reagan thought, "Well, I'll turn off my hearing aid." I think he did sometimes turn off his hearing aid, actually. But before he had a, you know, I don't think he said, "This is what I, this is how I deal with things. I ignore them." But I think he did. He did do that, and he did it. He did it more over time, and as certain things in his life hurt him and wounded him, he went. He went deeper into that. I mean, I don't try to put him on the couch. This is a little bit of a explanation, a little bit of a literary explanation. But I do think there's a fit. You know, Edmund Morris, who you're talking about, who wrote this kind of, I mean, it's sort of a famously disastrous biography, right? Because he had more access. They invited him into the White House in the second term. They said, you can basically be a fly on the wall. He had more access to Reagan than any historian has ever had to any president while he was in office. And he had all the time he wanted to interview Reagan and go with Reagan back to his hometown. And you know what he got? Exactly the same thing you got watching Reagan on TV. Mm-hmm. Reagan was the same. You could ask Reagan, you would get the same answer. Gerald Ford once made the observation, you know, the thing about Reagan is he's exactly the same in private and in public. And I think, you know, his conclusion from that was this. He says Reagan had no inner life. And I just think that's wrong. I just think what he should have said is, despite all of this access, I couldn't gain any access to Reagan's inner life. And at this point, I think it's very unlikely that we historians, people looking at it, are going to have some breakthrough access to Reagan's inner life. But it doesn't mean it wasn't there. It just means that he hid it very well.
I think someone in my business would say that maybe he was mostly in his inner life.
Yeah.
And I'm wondering how much control he had over the dissociation, the zoning out. I suspect that it just happened to him. And when you have it happen to an extreme, you really don't have much control over it. And if it's rewarding
right. And
makes you feel good, then who wants to exert control? So it's even a...
Well, yes, so just the last word. But I mean, if it makes you unhappy, people come see you. I mean, when people are made unhappy by... But it didn't make Reagan unhappy.
No, right.
Right. It was a way that
it
he stayed happy
yeah.
in the face of circumstances that would otherwise have made him unhappy.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah, thanks.
Thanks. Speaking of his inner life, you mentioned that he read a lot and wrote a lot. Did you get any sense of which authors, including fiction authors, he liked and inspired him? And indeed, how else did he spend his free time? And did he listen to music and go to the theater, cinema? What else did he do? And if I could ask a second question... can you speculate what he would make of this year's Republican candidates, including Donald Trump?
Yes. Well, I knew that was coming. First on what he did for fun. He loved to watch movies. I mean, he watched, and you know, he kept these meticulous diaries, and the diaries are a little Asperger's-y. He doesn't say anything about anything. He just says what happened. I mean, he writes down, you know, 74 haircuts. You know, I mean, he every time he gets a haircut, he goes to the doctor. He just writes, went to the doctor. This. And then as you get further along, I think it's partly how you can start to recognize the Alzheimer's. They're really very, very basic. But he writes down every movie he saw. And he and Nancy, that's what they would do every evening. They like to get their, you know, he knocked off work at 6 o'clock, whatever time. They got their TV trays out. They sat in front of the TV and they either watched something that was on TV or they got movies and had movies sent into Camp David. And he does write very enthusiastically. I mean, he seems to be more responsive to movies he sees than people he meets. And people, you know, the people in the diary are not a present. The movies he gets very excited about. And he's paying attention to who the actors are and who's good. He gets very offended when they use bad language or there's drug use. And why do they ruin that great movie by doing that? You know, I think his reading, I mean, he had one kind of reading when he was a boy and liked adventure stories. He had at another period in the 50s, he was very engaged in political literature. By the time he was president, he was reading. He liked to read Human Events, the right-wing newspaper, and his aides would try to keep it away from him because he would pick up these stories and fables, and he would go out and say things that were not true, and then they would have to walk them back, so they would constantly be hiding human events, and he would be finding it and getting it back. But the writing is interesting. I mean, if you really want to get a sense of how Reagan thought, I think these transcripts of the his radio commentaries from the late 70s are the most interesting thing, and they're really good, and they're written out in longhand with very few scratch outs. I mean, he kind of sat down and wrote them, and they're good. I mean, I said to someone the other day, we'd give them a column in Slate if we were looking for a political columnist. They're cogent. They're somewhat different. They're pretty far out there sometimes, but they were original and interesting. And it has that quality, you know, a little bit the Rush Limbaugh quality of you may violently disagree with it, but it's kind of compelling. You kind of want to keep listening or keep reading. The presidential field. I just did a kind of write-up of exactly this, which is in the FT tomorrow, if you want the kind of gory details. But, you know, it's sort of funny because Reagan is the patron saint of the Republican campaign. When they did the CNN debate at the Reagan Library, the candidates, I counted in the transcript, they invoked Reagan 38 times. They only mentioned God 10 times. So that gives you a sense of the actual hierarchy in the Republican Party now. I think it's a largely false myth. They're building up both of the idea of Reagan as a conservative purist, so as opposed to being a pragmatist and so on, but also in terms of what he thought. I mean, Reagan thought at least three things that would get him kicked out of the Republican Party today. One is about immigration. Reagan, there's a great quote from his 1984 debate with Walter Mondale, where Reagan says, I support amnesty for people who may have come here illegally, but who worked hard, who've lived in this country. He was a Southern Californian. He thought the idea of a border fence was appalling. I mean, this is a migrant labor force that moves back and forth across that border and picks the fruit and vegetables, and if they don't, the fruit and vegetables rot. I mean, he thought it was a necessity and it was a reality. He lived in a multicultural world filled with Mexican immigrants. And he liked the idea of immigration. You know, he didn't like walls. I mean, he's a view of immigration which would probably be barely tolerable in the Democratic Party, but certainly not in the Republican Party. He supported handgun control. After he got shot, he says, probably not a great idea to let people buy $20 handguns in pawn shops without background checks, right? And, you know, and because of what happened to Jim Brady. So he's for handgun control. You couldn't have that position today in the Republican Party. And the last one was abortion. I mean, Reagan changed his view on this, but he signed as governor of California something called the Therapeutic Abortion Bill, which probably did more at a national level to make abortion legal as Roe v. Wade. I mean, California was a big influential state early on. They passed this bill, and he supported it and signed it, that said your doctor can decide if you should have an abortion or not. And at that point, it became the discretion of a doctor, and it became very easy to get an abortion. And then that happened in lots of other states. Now, Reagan later said he regretted that, but imagine the scene of the Republican debate. It was like, you're the one who legalized abortion in this country. You can't say that was ultimately his view. So in some ways, it's not just how he held his views, but it's actually the views he held that would now make him, I mean, you can't say it would make him a liberal in the party on, you know, on taxes, on government. I think what most Republicans think is largely consistent with what Reagan thought, along with all the contradictions and impossibility of having it both ways that the Reagan economic plan embodied. But in other respects, it just shows you how certain things have become this required ideology in the Republican Party that were not 35 years ago.
Jake, we have two more.
Sure, and I think we have two more. Hardly. Thanks.
I come from an old Washington family, and we met Ronald Reagan many times. Anyway, my wife's father was Reagan's barber his whole term.
And he loved the haircut.
It was cheap. He didn't have to tip. Anyway, he knew a lot of secrets of Reagan. The first
I can
one,
think of one in particular.
The first one was the first one was hair.
Yeah, yeah.
And he would never talk about visiting the White House. Never. So he died with a lot of secrets. Anyway, tell me, I went to Notre Dame. Tell me about Reagan's special relationship with Notre Dame, especially with Father Hesburgh.
Okay, well, but first, can I ask you a little more about the hair?
Who dyes yours?
Well, as you can see, nobody. But having this hair at my age, I know that Reagan's hair color at his age is not plausible. Was your father-in-law the one who dyed it, do you think?
Well, it's like women. They say, I never dye my hair but with chemicals, but I use vegetables. And that's how they walk away from that, you know? You know, if you over-dye your hair, it falls out.
Yeah.
It disappears.
But your father-in-law was the vegetable man.
He always could have had a V8.
I see you've inherited his coyness on the subject.
Really?
Yeah.
No, he was asked many times. Yeah. Many, many times. 'Cause we're poor.
But now it can be told. Come on.
Only God knows.
Not true. But Nancy knows. There are a few people who know. But anyway, we know. We know. But on Notre Dame, you know, I think the, there's one part of that which
the Gipper.
The Gipper. So Reagan wanted to play George Gipp, this football legend, the one part in Hollywood he was desperate to get. In Newt Rockne, All-American. And he went after it, and he got this part. And, you know, that's where the Gipper comes
he
from.
He nearly didn't get it.
Yeah, no, that's right.
Pat O'Brien got it for him.
Yeah, well, you know this story better than
I'm
I
I'm a
did.
Notre Dame man. We have to know.
Yes, exactly. But there's a line. I watched a lot of the old Reagan movies when I was working on the book, which was a lot of fun. But there's a line in that movie that nobody focuses on. You know, everybody focuses on his deathbed speech, which is mythological, by the way, never happened. But
it's a good myth.
Yeah, it's a good myth. But the line in that movie is, which is kind of true about what George Gipp was really like. He said, "I don't like people to get close to me." And I thought that's a line that really resonates with Reagan. That's a way in which Reagan really was like that character.
You should know when Hesburgh would visit the White House, yeah. Reagan would show Newt Rockne.
Yeah. Yeah. Thank you. Last question. We'll do quickly.
Thank you. Could you follow up, please, on the comment that was made during the introduction to the effect that I think you might think that Reagan was the second most influential president in the 20th century, or since FDR at any rate?
Yeah, I do think that. I mean, I think if you take a long perspective, you had a liberal progressive wave, which, well, you could say the New Deal era, forget the earlier progressive part of it, begins with Roosevelt's election in 1932 and really lasts until Reagan's elected in 1980. Because in a lot of ways, the Republican presidents in that period were, in many respects, liberal presidents. Government continued to expand. The overall New Deal project continued during those years. And, of course, you had Democratic Congresses in all but four of those years. So when you had Republican presidents with Democratic Congresses, they tended to perpetuate the direction that was underway. And Reagan halted that. There's an interesting argument about how much he reversed it, because he didn't really shrink government. The federal government was about the same size when he left office as a share of the economy as it was when he was elected. But government stopped growing, and he gave rise to a movement that still holds, as we were saying a second ago, to his fundamental beliefs, that is the modern conservative movement that I think you could argue that since 1980 we've been living in the age of Reagan. And just as the Republican presidents were Republican presidents in a liberal era before that, the Democratic presidents have been Democratic presidents in a largely conservative era since then. So I think changing the direction of government, challenging the role of government, stopping the growth of expansion of government in the way he did, was what he set out to do. It was an enormous project, and I think he was enormously effective at it. Not the only things he was effective at, but if you think which presidents really, really changed the country, I would say FDR and Reagan in the 20th century.
Thanks.
Thank you.